Some days.
Servant Leadership Council, which is the board of the church for this year. I have
it's on. Number 22. Is it unmuted?
Can everybody?
There we go. Yes. You sound great to us.
Okay. Anyhow, my name is Robert Brody, for those of you that may not know me. And for this year, I am chairman of the Servant Leadership Council, and that is the board of the church. This morning, I have a distinct honor and privilege to introduce the newest member of our church staff. One of the important facets that the SLC wanted to address was that of our children and youth program. This is an important part in a growing church, and we recognize that this is something that we need to do. The SBRC and Pastor Sandy conducted diligent search and interview process, and I will let our new staff tell yourself about her, but will you please welcome the director of our children's ministry, Amy White.
To serve in the church.
Thank you.
I know.
This month, our rail offering is for the Good Samaritan Fund. Some of you may have heard of this fund. It is for those in our church, family, and community through times, is to help those in our church, family, and community in times of financial crisis or burden. The fund is overseen by our leadership council, and it may be used to help pay bills, utilities, car repairs, transportation, food, urgent home care repairs, or other critical needs. So this month, we would love for you to pray about that and be willing to help us to build that fund back up. The second part of what I want to talk to you about has to do with compiling a list of referrals for practical help, for practical needs. There are two parts to this. We are compiling a list of resources for volunteers, you in our church, that have the abilities and the talents to help others in our church. Maybe you're a handyman, a handy woman. You can help with some minor plumbing or electrical jobs or carpentry work. Perhaps you can help with meals, yard work, cleaning, child care, anything like that. The other part of this, pulling this list together, is for paying for service contractors, providing a list of service contractors. As you know, sometimes it's difficult to find good help, right? And we all like to get referrals from people that we know and that we trust. And so we're putting together a list of contractors that you can use for home, car maintenance, yard services, again, handymen, other professionals such as financial planners, lawyers, realtors, anything where you would need to get some professional help. And we realize, we know that a lot of you are already doing this in our church, just one-on-one, but what we're trying to do is put it together in a little more formal and orderly fashion so that those in need in our church, when they need some type of service or help, then we know who we can go to, or we can give them this list and they can reach out to you directly. And it's not just for our church, it's for people that we know in our community too. So again, thank you for praying about this and for being willing to help and serve in this capacity. We really appreciate it. If you have any questions, you can reach out to any of us on the mission committee. That's Pastor Sandy, Dana Gilliland, Barbara Rohde, Barbara Light, and Joe Vaughn, and myself. So thank you.
Thank you. So we had a long announcement, and I say this because wonderful Sandy has given me a text message this morning what to say verbatim. Hello, my name is Kim Long, and this is what people look forward to. But my phone has been used for the online stuff. So I'm going to do it by somewhat memory. If you would look at your bulletin and have all the things that we need, the Samaritan Fund that's going to be today for communion, Breath of Life that's happening this coming Friday. Nine and Dine is here, so if you like to golf and eat, Tom is your man for that, right? And if you go to the very last page, you have these two little QR codes. One is for giving, and the other one is for registering your attendance. And if you missed all that, please download our app, FUMC Heath, on Apple as well as Android, and it has all the information, including weekly bulletin. I get to update that. I'm very proud of it every week. I don't know who checks it, but it's there. We get our picture directory soon. It's coming. It's getting there. But for those of you who are new or didn't get a chance to take a picture, please be here next week on Mother's Day, and you get your picture taken, and we'll put it in there. It should be here by end of May. With all that said, if you will prepare your heart, mind, soul, and strength of any kind, and please stand as we recite our belief of reciting our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
Yeah, you have to pay attention, right? Because when I played back in the day, in the late 1900s, when I was playing this game, thank you, Simon would try to go really fast.
Yeah.
And so be like, Simon says, touch your head. Simon says, touch your belly. Simon says, touch your feet. Now touch your elbow. And it'd be like, ah, and you would be in such a routine of doing the things and hearing that Simon said to do them that your brain would think like, oh, I think Simon said to, you know, touch my elbow, and you do it, and then, you know, according to our friend here, you might die. No, I mean, you'd be out of the game for that round. So it's so important to pay attention. I know, do a lot of the grown-ups have something like this in the room?
Yeah.
You have this?
Yeah.
Okay, my weekly report just popped up. Did anybody else's weekly report just pop up on your phone to tell you how much time you were paying attention to it? Mine said, dear Jessica, I'm so sad because you spent 16% less time with me this week. And I said, good, because I would much rather be paying attention to the people in my life who are really with me than sometimes scared at this thing. There are fun games on here, and sometimes I like to play them, especially when I feel bored, but it's so important to make sure I'm still paying attention to the people around me. Also, there's someone that we can't see right now, and we can't necessarily touch.
Jesus!
Yes, exactly right! But should we still pay attention to Jesus? So how do we pay attention to Jesus if we can't see him and we can't touch him? How do we pay attention?
Look at the sky.
He talks to you? Yeah. So all the time you have the opportunity to pay attention to God, to pay attention to Jesus, to help us get through all the seasons of our lives, because sometimes are really fun and sometimes not so much. And so at all times we can pay attention to Jesus and he'll help us get through it. So do we end children's time by praying? Well, I do. So let's pray. Put your hands together or however you want to pray and repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for loving us and thank you for always being there for us. Help us to pay attention to you so that we can live to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Awesome. Thank y'all so much for coming. You can head back. That happens sometimes. I have two boys as well, and sometimes that just happens. So, can you return to their seats? Off you go. There you go. If you need to, because your Bible's on it, by all means, because we're going to be in our Bibles today. But now we come to that time in worship when we live into our calling as God's people to pray with and for one another, to lift up those things that we brought with us through the door, whether they feel light or whether they feel unspeakably heavy. And so what things would y'all like to pray for this morning? And after each one, we're just going to say, Lord, in your mercy, and you'll say, hear our prayers. So what prayers do we bring?
All those affected in Allen, Texas.
Absolutely. So the last church I served was First United Methodist Church of Allen. And so that landed a particular way yesterday. And so we pray for the community of Allen. The mayor is a member of First Allen, and so I just texted him. And I'm praying for the senior pastor that I served with there, because it will be an interesting, a strange, a shocking, a hard day to get up and preach a good word of good news for people who need it. And this is absolutely when we need it. So, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Well, we know, we have confidence that God hears us even when we can't find the words to our prayers, right? And so whatever you brought with you, know that God hears it and we lift it up. Let us continue in a spirit of prayer. Holy God, your strange ways astound us. Among the mighty, your wisdom is called foolish. While some assert their power with force, yours unfolds like an invitation. You turn from all paths of domination. Beauty and truth are your means of persuasion, and freedom is your promise. While the powers of this world shout false promises of security, using fear to turn us against each other, you whisper the mysterious authority of vulnerability, of meals at table and sharing what we have, of solidarity and new life. When you took on flesh, you sought neither thrones nor prestige, but made your friends among the outcast, the imprisoned, the hungry and the ill, the fed up and the weary. Though you were presented with every opportunity to seek importance among the elite, to the end you chose the edges, making your home among the vulnerable, living in solidarity with the criminalized and despised. Holy God, make us faithful to this peculiar calling of Christ, unafraid to bear the names of the despised, firmly planted in the confidence of your strange love that calls us to fight for each other and awakens us to the joy you set before us. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Beloved of God, when I walked in today, I was struck by the beauty of this space. I know sometimes we can become so familiar with things. I mean, it's like marriage, right? You become so familiar with your beloved that you forget the things that you love about them because you start noticing all the other things that are maybe not so lovely. But when I walked in today, I thought, what a beautiful space to come and be surrounded by God's love. And I know that all of this is built on the legacy of those who were fearless in their giving, who were moved to generosity by God's grace in their life. And so we continue to have that opportunity to give a portion of what we have received out of God's abundance so that God's work and God's ministry might continue to be done. And so I invite the ushers forward at this time to receive our offering. And as they come forward to receive the plates, let us pray. Holy and gracious God, by your grace and by your power, what we give today is able to do more than we could ever think or imagine. And so, God, bless this offering that it might be to your glory, whether it jingles or rustles or whether it flies through the internet. We give you glory in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you. I invite you to pray with me and for me. Holy God, you know what we need in this moment. You know what ache or what joy got us to jump out of bed this morning, to crawl out of bed this morning, and to come to this place, hopeful that we might hear a word from you. And so, God, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Spirit, that we might find exactly what we need. Through or in spite all that's said or done, in Christ's name, amen. So, did anyone read the title in the bulletin of the message? Okay. Well, when most of us talk about the economy, I know I get that feeling of dread right in my wallet. Anyone else? The economy feels like the price of gas or eggs or houses. And the reality is that most of us haven't seen raises in pay to keep up with the increases, if we've seen a raise at all. The economy, in this sense, can feel like some big machine that we're all stuck in, trying to figure out how we have enough to have enough. But one of the textbook definitions of economy is the careful management of available resources. So we're right to think about housing and food and money as some of those resources, but we also find ourselves in an age of endless, endless information that can be found with a few wiggles of our fingers across a screen. And now we have entered into what folks are calling the attention economy. The term was coined by psychologist, economist, and Nobel laureate Herbert Simon, who wrote that attention was the bottleneck of human thought that limits both what we can perceive in stimulating environments and what we can do, right? Our brain can only handle so much at a time. As he also noted that a wealth of information creates a poverty of attention because everybody wants a piece of it. As fewer people are involved with manufacturing, as we move kind of away from an industrial economy, emerging careers work with information and finding ways to get that information in front of people, to make them pay with their attention. Our attention is a limited, valuable resource, and we all need the attention of others. Babies cry to get the attention that they need to be held, to be fed, to be cared for. Married couples come for counseling, and more often than not, the first thing they talk about is how their partner no longer pays attention to them in ways that feel loving. And it's probably something that we've all felt at one time or another. Even before the pandemic, a study in 2019 reported that 60% of Americans felt lonely on a regular basis. We forget to give each other some attention. And clever companies have figured out how to monetize the attention we give them. Is it any wonder that in kindergarten, the very end of his kindergarten year, my youngest said, "I want to be a YouTuber." And I thought, no, you don't. Where we put our attention matters. Our money, our minds, even our hearts follow the path of our attention. In my house, we love things that go fast on wheels. Anybody else in here? We love the Tour de France, and we love F1, and we love NASCAR, or at least what the TV is showing thinks that we love all of these things. I usually go take a nap. But one thing that a driver said has really stuck with me. The driver said, when we're out on the track, we have to be looking at where we want to go coming out of a turn. Not where we're going right now, but where we want to be going. Because if we look at the wall, even for a moment, even though we know we don't want to hit it, what happens? You hit the wall, because where you put your attention matters. Our scripture text this morning gives us a few different models for how we can use our attention. but a little background would probably be helpful. Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, is the story of the church after the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Christ. The church, full of grace and power as the Holy Spirit moves, and many come to believe in God's work through Jesus Christ. Folks are selling their fields and pooling their money. They're eating and praying and caring for each other. It sounds, friends, it sounds like heaven on earth, but it's still earth. And so there are some points of friction. At the beginning of chapter 6, we hear about one rub when the Hellenists complain to the disciples that the widows in their community aren't being cared for as well as the Hebrew widows. So the community gathers and they choose 7 men full of the Spirit and of wisdom who are appointed to the task of waiting on tables or keeping accounts, depending on your translation. Stephen is one of those 7. Just 2 sentences later. So here's the part, if you have a Bible, right now we're in chapter 6, verse 8 of Acts. So in verse 8 we read, "Stephen, full of grace and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. Then some of those who belonged to the synagogue of the freedmen, as it was called, Cyrenians, Alexandrians, and others of those from Cilicia and Asia stood up and argued with Stephen. But they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he spoke. Then they secretly instigated some men to say, 'We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and God.' They stirred up the people as well as the elders and the scribes. Then they suddenly confronted him, seized him, and brought him before the council. They set up false witnesses who said, 'This man never stops saying things against this holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and will change the customs that Moses handed on to us.' And all who sat in the council looked intently at him, and they saw that his face was like that of an angel." We move into chapter 7, and it's primarily Stephen's response to these charges. He begins with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph, and then Moses and David and Solomon, retelling the story of their faith to these leaders who should know it. And then as we move through this Easter season, it strikes me that Jesus does this same work when he shows up after his resurrection, whether it's with Cleopas and his companion on the road to Emmaus, or the disciples who are huddling afraid in the upper room. Even after folks got to see and touch and hear Jesus, the incarnate Word of God, many times they still didn't understand. Over and over again, we retell the story that makes us who we are, and if we're paying attention, it changes us. Well, you can imagine how Stephen's words went over with the council. They were furious. How dare he? He's spoken the truth to them. And just like their ancestors, they persecute and kill the prophets, including the Messiah himself. And so we find our reading for today from Acts chapter 7, beginning in verse 54. So let us listen together for a word from God. "When they," the council, "heard these things, they became enraged and ground their teeth at Stephen. But filled with the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. 'Look,' he said, 'I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God.' But they covered their ears, and with a loud shout, all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him, and the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, 'Lord Jesus, receive my spirit.' Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, 'Lord, do not hold this sin against them.' When he had said this, he died." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Most churches I've served have had a tradition of giving Bibles to third graders. Do y'all give Bibles to the kids? You ever wonder what we're handing them when we read stories like this? This is a disturbing story. But maybe sometimes we've heard it so many times that the brutality doesn't land the same way in our bodies like it would if we were hearing it for the first time. When I wrote this sermon on Wednesday, the next thing I said was, in the same way that we hear about another shooting on the news. But this is a terrible death for Stephen, the price he paid for speaking truth to power. Even after Easter, the world is not warm, it's not fuzzy, it's not transformed. Sometimes our Easter trumpets are silenced by the shock of human brutality. But I know that God can speak to us even through the most uncomfortable, painful parts of the Bible and of our lives. So I invite us to consider how the people in this text used their attention. First, there's Stephen. He must have known what the likely consequence of speaking the truth would be. I mean, he knew Jesus' story and the death that came from living a life so full of God's grace and truth and so contrary to the world's traditions. But he also knew that death was not the end of the story. So Stephen gazed to heaven and invited others to gaze with him using the imperative, look. This gaze, which is the Greek word atenesio, is more than just mere physical sight. It implies a deeper perception, an intentional focus of awareness on Jesus. He gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. While everyone around him is upset, caught up in the drama, outraged, Stephen maintained a steady focus beyond the fray, beyond the noise. His eyes were fixed on Jesus. Stephen doesn't try to tune out or escape what's happening, but gives his attention to the reality of Emmanuel, God with us in every moment. This reminds me of Jesus' words in the Gospels over and over again about having eyes to see and ears to hear. In the Gospels, Jesus invites listeners to the intentional awareness that God is up to something in the middle of everyday life, even right here, even right now. This way of seeing expands our frame of reference, freeing us from reacting to whatever the latest drama might be. Stephen's gaze is a prophetic and defiant act. When we use our attention this way, we refuse to hand over our consciousness to the loudest voice in the room or the most frightening bully. His fixed attention proclaims the reign of God right here and right now, even in the face of an angry mob. Next in the story, we have the council members. When they heard Stephen's testimony, they were enraged. Other translations say they were cut to the heart. I recognize this feeling. I'll just confess, I recognize this feeling. Maybe you do too. They heard the truth, and it stung. It cut them to the quick because it was true. They recognized themselves, and they didn't want to be those people. So they turned their attention away. Back in chapter 6, verse 15, the council members had given their attention to Stephen. They looked intently at him, and they perceived that he was radiant. They saw that he had the face like an angel. I want to say they perceived the Spirit's presence in him, that he was a messenger of God. But the truth shows them something they don't want to see. So they let out shrieks and shouts. They cover their ears so they don't have to hear Stephen anymore. And they rush to destroy him. So My kiddos have been in play therapy. I'm a big believer in therapy for all ages. I think everybody needs a therapist, whether you see them regularly or whether you just have them available for when you need them. But I'll never forget something I learned from our play therapist. He gave me this way of understanding our brains and what happens when something happens too much, too soon, too fast. So imagine my hand is our brain. I know, imagine. And this part up here is the big, beautiful, logical part, right? All the higher order thinking happens in this part. And when trauma happens, when we become dysregulated, when we lose it, when we flip out, this big logical part goes, ah! Not physically, this is metaphorically. Leaving just this little lizard brain, the amygdala, to keep us safe. Now, unfortunately, the amygdala only has a few primordial commands at its disposal. It can say, freeze. It can say, flee. Or it can say, fight. And in the worst cases, in the most extreme cases, it might say, annihilate. You are under threat. This is so dangerous, you must destroy the threat. There's research out there that suggests that trauma can impact our genetics, that the trauma we experience becomes an ingrained response that gets lodged in those little lizard brains, gets passed down to our children. And when I read the story of our ancestors of faith, when I think about what God's own people have been through, from slavery to Exodus, to kingdom building, to exile, to living as an occupied territory in a brutal empire, it's no wonder that the religious leaders behave this way. We can be shocked. But maybe we're not surprised, because hurt people hurt people. Stephen represents a threat to the system, and these council members have power in what already exists. It may not be perfect, but it's theirs. So while in their logical minds, they might think that they want the reign of God, they want the kingdom of God, their little lizard brains know a threat when they see it, and they destroy it. They aren't able to see, to pay attention to what God is doing. And in case we forget, there's one more person who is named in this story, a young man named Saul. He was the one looking after the coats while the others threw stones at Stephen. After all, you don't want to get your clothes all sweaty while you're doing what you're doing to someone's body. This is the very first time we hear Saul's name mentioned. This is when we meet him. And I wonder how this experience was formative to him. Later on, when he's known as Paul, he describes himself in this way in a letter to the Philippians. If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. He had impeccable credentials, genetically and professionally. Just like those members of the council, Saul was a religious leader. He was a know-it-all. In fact, I know this happens to me, and maybe it happens to you. He knew it all so well, he didn't have to pay attention anymore. There's so much danger in this. If we turn to the very verse after our reading for today, the very first verse of chapter 8 in Acts, we read, "And Saul approved of their killing Stephen. That day, a severe persecution began against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout the countryside of Judea and Samaria. But Saul was ravaging the church by entering house after house, dragging off both men and women. He committed them to prison." In thinking that he knew what God wanted, in thinking that he knew God's will and that he was carrying it out, Saul behaved in exactly the opposite way from what God truly intended. Saul did not look when Stephen cried out to all of those gathered to pay attention, to see what he was seeing, the glory of God in heaven, and Jesus right there at God's right hand. The act of violence committed by the council didn't stay confined to that one day, that one death. No, it infected all of the bystanders so that the pain and suffering rippled out over countless more followers of Jesus. I feel like there's one more lesson in this text for us this week. It caught my eye and it convicted me. And I know when God convicts me, there might be something there to offer to others. So I wanted to share it. Stephen's attention doesn't shy away from injustice. It doesn't gloss over their transgressions. He speaks the painful truth. But his gaze, his attention is never focused on the wrongdoers. It was so startling, I went back and read it again. Because I know what conflict looks like now, in this day and age. Probably looked the same back then. When someone is mad at you, when you know you've told them something they don't want to hear, usually we look at them. We stare hard at them. We point out every flaw. We bring our attention to them like it's a sledgehammer. But Stephen doesn't do that. His attention was fixed on God even as he spoke the truth to them. He sees the kingdom. He sees the reign of God. He knows God's life here and now, and so he has no fear except for the continuing trauma that these beloved children of God are doing to themselves as they pick up those stones. Who does that? Who can face death and be worried about the one who is giving that death? Well, Jesus did it. And Stephen followed his Lord's example. In the midst of pain, he keeps his attention on God, praying, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And when it became too much, when he could no longer stand, when he fell to the ground, Stephen yelled out, "Lord, don't hold this sin against them." Even in the midst of cruelty, by the grace of God, Stephen kept his attention on God's love and God's mercy. It made me wonder if it's so worth getting angry at those other drivers on the highway. You know the ones. You probably have names for them too. Or whether it's so frustrated, or whether it's worth it to get so frustrated for the 53rd time that my children finish eating and they put the plate on the edge of the countertop when it goes like just right there in the dishwasher. And I wonder how we can right here and right now keep speaking the truth to those in power about where we all fall short, and yet still passionately want the best for them. It's not easy. It's much easier. You know this. It is much easier to love lovable people. People who probably are more like us, who agree with us on important things. But here's what I also know is true. The folks who are the very closest to me, my husband, my children, my sister, my mother, they do not think the same way I do about everything, even though I wish they did. They don't. And I love them. I'm hopeful that if we learn from Stephen's example, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, then we can escape the cycles of reactivity and harm and see what new thing God is already doing. And the best news of all is that we have the opportunity to be a part of it. Glory to God. Amen. I know that was a heavy text. I'm sorry. The lectionary did it. That's the gift of the lectionary, to be honest. The lectionary is this 3-year cycle of readings that makes us read a good portion of the Bible, not all of it, but it moves us right out of our comfort zones. So we move into this time of Holy Communion. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who seek to grow into his likeness. So let us draw near with faith and make our humble confession and prepare to receive this holy sacrament. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Beloved of God, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, proving God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery under sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This bread has been broken, as my body will be broken, to forgive your sins. Do this as often as you eat bread, and remember me." And when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup and gave thanks to God, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. Like this cup has been poured out, my blood will be poured out to forgive your sins. Do this as often as you drink it. And remember me." And so, in remembrance of your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. As forgiven and reconciled children of God, we are bold to pray as Jesus taught his disciples, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Would those who are assisting with serving communion please come forward?
Thank you.
Beloved of God, thank you for being here today. And I'm so grateful for Kim and her leadership and for our musicians and for back at the booth and the video. So many people do so many things to make church happen. And I'm so grateful for all of you. So receive this blessing. You are beloved of God. And God is calling you to bring that love out into the world, because there are people for whom love is a stranger. And you will see them, and you will find them, and you will know them when we pay attention. So go, for you are sent in Christ's name. And the church said, Amen. Amen.